You're watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. Follow along with projects and footage with a premium download available at BorisFX.com.
Hello again. So we're going to follow on with the next clip in our exercise 3 composition, which is the pullback from Weir clip. And I'm going to apply Mocha again and come in to the Mocha interface. And let's play back our clip. And we can just check out the movement on this particular clip. Now, we can see that it's a drone shot and we're sort of moving back from this weir. Now, what I want to do in this particular shot is track this area here. I'm not sure what these are, some sort of buoys of some sort. And we're just going to track those in. Now we've answered the question, what do we want to track? Now we have to ask the question, where do we want to track? And here we're going to start at the front because this is our sharpest frame. And it's also the frame where we have the most details about these elements as well. They're bigger, they're closer to the camera at this stage. So let's come out to our tools and decide what shape we want to track in. And I think in this case, I'm going to use the rectangular spline tool once again and just click and drag around here. Now there's a couple of things we need to be a bit concerned about. I don't want to make this shape too big. And the reason for that is because we are seeing a lot of non-coplanar elements in the background here. So especially as we move up and out, all of these elements at the back share a different relationship to the camera than these floating buoys do down here. So I want to make this shape just a little bit bigger than the elements I need to track in. I also need to be careful of the reflections as well, because these are definitely not coplanar. Now, Mocha's tracker is robust enough that we can keep in some of these smaller elements and not have any problems, but you know, it's just something to be aware of and watch out for. Let's set up our surface by turning it on up at the top to make sure that what we're tracking in is actually consistent with what we need. And we can see the surface, a little blue box in there. I'm going to drag this up just out a little bit. So we can move and transform the surface tool as much as we want to. There are no keyframes on the surface tool. So we can have this all tracked in and then reposition this, and the surface is going to just show us that same tracking data, that same tracking offset, no matter where we place it. This makes the surface very powerful, as we're going to see, you know, in later exercises. So I can transform the whole thing around by clicking and dragging in the center box here with the little crosshairs. I can make it bigger by clicking and dragging on any of the edges, so we can make it bigger along the sides. And if I click on the corners, I can then be changing those individual corners up. Let's undo that with Control or Command Z. If I grab any of the dots on the edges, we're going to get both the opposing edges moving simultaneously, so growing out from the center. So here, let's just place this, place it around about here. It doesn't need to be, you know, exact for any reason. And we could use the grid again. So turn the grid back on. And the grid is a great way of checking accuracy because it's based off of the planar shape that's defined by the surface, but it's bigger. Any small issues we have with our tracking are going to be amplified and made a lot bigger when we're looking at the grid. So this is a great way for checking accuracy. So now we have all that set up, let's come over to our track motion options. And here, we don't just have a translation, we don't have position X and Y changing. We also have the camera moving back as well. So when the camera moves back or forwards, or when the objects we're tracking move back and forwards, we're changing that relationship to the camera. So we can't just rely on translation, obviously, to give us the best results. So I'm going to make sure that we're tracking in translation and scale. So I'll turn off rotation, and that will turn off anything higher up in the hierarchy. And let's just track that forwards. So it's interesting to see now that even though our surface is completely offset from the shape, the tracking data that we're getting only comes from the shape. The surface, and by extension the grid, are just tools that we're using to check accuracy of the track. They're not affecting or contributing to the track. So if we play that back, that's looking pretty accurate. The things to look out for if this was inaccurate is that the grid would start to jump around and not sort of maintain the same sort of motion as we're getting with the, you know, the surrounding elements, or we would see some sort of drift happening as well, and we're not seeing drift. Another way to test our track to make sure this is actually good is to insert something into our surface area. So I'm going to turn off the grid to make this a bit simpler. And I'm going to come into layer properties. So we're still in the essentials workspace. So layer properties is next to essentials. If you're in classic workspace, then layer properties is underneath, probably around about here somewhere. And I'm going to come into my insert clip. And I'm just going to change this to logo. We could put in like a grid in here, but that's difficult to see. So I'm just going to put in a big logo. And I'm just going to make a change to my surface here, just to show you that changing the surface doesn't actually change any of the tracking data. All it does is change the shape of the surface. So the underlying tracking data that is driving this surface is exactly the same still. As we play that back, we can see that that is sitting in there absolutely perfectly. I can even turn my surface off up at the top as well, and we're just left with the logo. Okay, so that was tracking in with translation and scale and inserting our logo in here. I'm going to save this and exit. We're not going to do anything else with this data right now. We're going to come back to using the data in a later exercise. What I want to do now, though, is come to our next clip, which is our back to our playing card. But let's have a look at this again in Mocha. So I apply the Mocha plugin. And all the things that we're seeing here are going to be absolutely the same, whether we're working in the plugin or the standalone or the version of Mocha that is bundled within plugins as well. And as you can see, we're back to our playing card again, only this time it's doing a slightly different type of motion. Well, guess what sort of motion we're looking at now? Yes, we are looking at rotation. So as it spins around, this is rotation. Okay, so we know what we're tracking. We're going to track the middle of the playing card again. And we're going to come to a frame which is good. In fact, both the start frame and the end frame are nice and clear. We'll begin at the end, I think. And let's come in and do something, you know, similar to what we did last time when we were looking at the translation. I'm just going to draw a shape around. Actually, I believe I did the whole playing card there, so we'll try that one again. There we go, and we'll set up our surface. Very important to set up the surface, otherwise you don't know what's happening with the actual tracking. There we go, and I will turn on the grid. Excellent. So far, so good. Now we come over to our Mocha track options, and I'm going to turn off skew, so we're only tracking in translation, scale, and rotation now. And I'm going to track this one backwards. And I'm going to stop this already. Okay. So let's take a look at what's happened here. And I've got my finger over the space bar because I'm going to hit the space bar to start and stop the playback. Right, already there from its first turn, basically. It starts to slip just there. You see that? Of course you do. You have eyes. And we can probably tell why it's slipping, because it's at this time where the movement of the card starts to go fast. And you see that because we're getting a lot of increased motion blur around the edges. If we have a look just a few frames later, when there's really a lot of movement, it doesn't seem to know what to do with that. It's kind of just sort of stuck, just goes, I'm not sure. Okay, so what do we do? How do we get this looking more accurate? Well, there's a couple of things we can do to get a proper track on this very easily. I'm going to come up to my layer controls over here. I'm just going to double click on layer one, and I'm just going to rename this one bad. It's inaccurate. It's bad. I'm going to also turn off the tracking on it. I'm going to turn off the visibility on it as well. And just so we don't get confused, I'm going to turn off the surface and the grid. Okay, so we need to make a new shape. And I'm going to make a shape that exploits Mocha's planar tracking. Because remember, the plane that we create can then be expanded across the whole of that coplanar area. I'm going to come up back to our rectangular tool, rectangular layer tool, and I'm going to create a new rectangular layer. And this time I'm going to limit it so it's a lot smaller than it was previously. So let's just avoid some of the edges there. Might even make this smaller. We'll see how this works out. So we've got a much smaller area. I'm going to set up my surface again, just as we did before. Remember, if we don't have the surface on, we have absolutely no idea how accurate our tracking data actually is. That's good enough for jazz. And let's turn on the grid as well, because this will make it easier. So I'm going to turn off the skew. So again, we've only got translation, scale, and rotation. Let's see what a difference this makes. Okay, I'm going to hit escape again. And we can see we've got a different result. It still isn't an accurate result, but it's a different one. At least in this case, we're getting, you know, a lot more of that rotation. You know, as it rotates faster, it is trying to sort of get around and figure out what's going on there. But I think we can do better. And we can do better by changing one parameter. And this is a parameter that's not available in the Essentials mode. And the reason it's not available is because most of the time we're not dealing with, you know, heavy rotation like we are here. So I'm going to come into Classic mode. And this is the first time we've really worked in Classic mode. And this has the same basic idea as Essentials. So we have the layers still in the same place. Layer properties are down where I said they would be in the last exercise. But our motion controls are now a series of checkboxes rather than nice buttons. And it also exposes up a lot of other things for us to look at. Now, I'm going to ignore all of these for now. As the course goes on, we're going to revisit some of these as and when we need to. But the only one we need to look at now is this search area. And search area is controlling what Mocha is looking for in the previous or next frames as it's tracking through. And as you can see, these are set to auto on the horizontal and the vertical. And we have an angle down here and a zoom percentage down here as well. So what the angle and the zoom percentage do is it primes Mocha to look for certain changes in the image. So we have a big crash zoom or a fast moving object moving close to the camera, we might need to bring up the zoom percentage here. In the same way, because we have this fast angle change, we're going to need to tell Mocha to be on the lookout for a fast angle change. I'm going to bring this up. I'll bring this to 9 degrees. So this is the value that it's changing between frames. 9 degrees might actually be good enough. Let's have a little look. And as we're not in Essentials mode, our tracking buttons have moved from over here to next to the playback controls. So let's just track that back now. We can stop that. And we can see already that's looking a lot better. It's almost able to get it properly. So maybe I'll bring this angle up again, maybe to 13 degrees. I can even shrink down the area that I'm looking at. So with our shape, just make the shape a little bit smaller as well, so that it's not going to get as affected by the motion blur. And again, let's just track that backwards. And that's holding in a lot better. So we can see that's actually rotating in quite nicely. It's not 100% perfect yet, but we can figure that out. But at some stage, like here, it's going like really fast again. So what I'll do is at this point, I'll change the shape one more time. And this is the another great little technique that we can do with Mocha, is we can change the shape and the surface itself stays the same. So we can change the shape, retrack, and that actually gives us the additional information we need to get over that tricky situation. And that's pretty good. We're not 100% lined up in the corners, but I think that's the same sort of problems we were seeing with the translation, is that this isn't a a perfect rotation. This is also, the card is also moving slightly in a different way. But if we check out the center point of our surface, which is just off center off her belt, we go to the end here. Again, it's just off center on the belt. So with a little bit of extra tweaking, we probably could get this in an even better state. Let's turn this back to essentials mode so we can focus a bit more on the viewer. And for something that's a very, very difficult thing to track, that's not done too bad a job just with a couple of simple changes to it. I know that Mary's going to be talking about these more advanced parameters in a later exercise as well. So in this exercise, we've gone through quite a lot. We've looked at different ways that we can use the surface to check out our tracking integrity. We've looked at scale track motion and rotate track motion, and some of the more advanced things that we can do when our tracking doesn't want to play quite right. In the next exercise, we're going to be looking at the last two buttons we have in our track motion options, skew and perspective. We're going to see what the differences are between these two and how we can tell if our object is going to respond better to skew or perspective. And there's also going to be a fine little quiz where we look at real world footage and discuss which of these motion track options are going to be the best to get the results we want. So join me in the next and final part of exercise 3, Introduction to Mocha's Planar Tracker.
You've been watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. To download all videos, projects and footage, purchase the premium version available at borisfx.com.